Please welcome to the stage your MC for tonight, WAFF 48's very own Liz Hurley.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the 2017 Space Camp Hall of Fame ceremony. Tonight, hundreds of alumni and their families are here from all over the world, all to honor the passion and the achievement of four incredible individuals. Tonight is also a big celebration, 35 years of Space Camp. Woo! This program and this culture in this place in history is like no other place in the galaxy. A community of 800,000 graduates, 800,000 graduates involving 143 countries. Simply amazing. Space Camp alumni are a group like no other. They are biomedical researchers, they are aerospace engineers, aviators, special needs educators, opera singers, government officials, astronauts, architects, all with a common language, their love of space exploration. Earlier this year, Time Incorporated produced a little documentary called The Mars Generation. It premiered at the Sundance Film Festival. How many of you saw it? We should see all hands there. Well, a film crew, for those of you who don't know, followed a group of exceptional young people as they spent 2 weeks at space camp. The movie captures the spirit of bold curiosity, the human spirit, and the audacious dreams that define the space camp experience. Let's watch a clip.
Red leader checking in.
I was directly told that we cannot land on Mars before we do a med check.
Okay, pressure's going down.
Get them out of here.
Are we dead?
All in a day's work.
When we look at the night sky, we say to ourselves, are there any planets out there that are possible homes for humanity?
Space camp opened the path for me to do things that I really want to do.
Kids today have that same drive, that same passion that I had watching the first American launch into space.
High fives all around.
High fives all around.
We've gotten to the moon, but it's a stepping stone to the red planet.
It would be so amazing to see the Martian surface with my own eyes.
Having a man or woman walk on Mars is just the most badass thought in my mind. It's been over 50 years since we've done something significant like this.
We don't really go to space anymore. People are losing touch with their human spirit.
We have an entire generation who want to go to Mars, but all of that will fall on fallow soil if there isn't some big mission where they can apply this enthusiasm.
Some people think it's fine to just stay on Earth forever, and some people don't.
Let's go out there and make discoveries. Let's change the world.
Somebody from my generation will put their footprint in the Martian soil.
I can't think of a better thing to be defined by.
It's our duty to breathe fire into the imagination of these young people because our true place is among the stars.
Now, if you have not seen The Mars Generation, it is a spot-on portrayal of the mission, the passion, the spirit of space camp. And the greatest part about it is the young people, really, it involves their lives each and every day here at Space Camp. It embodies their potential, their drive, their ambition, their opportunity to change our world and so many others. It is a beautiful reminder of why we love Space Camp. So tonight, as you listen to our excellent slate of speakers and inductees, remember that you can make a difference by supporting Space Camp through the Space Camp Scholarship Fund. We have a very simple way that you can do that. And I hope everyone has their cell phone available. Everybody got your cell phone? Go ahead and pull it out. Thank you, Graham. I appreciate it. Here is mine. Okay, so you're going to catch your cell phone. You see the slide in back of me. If you all can text, can you text? Do I hear everyone out there? Do I see hands? Everyone can text, right? You will know, text CAMP 35 to 41444. That means when you pull up your phone where it says phone, then you go ahead and push keypad, and that's where you go ahead and dial 41444. You'll next get a cue. You will type in CAMP 35. That stands for Space Camp 35th Anniversary. It'll give you instructions on how you can help men and women from all around the world launch their dreams here at Space Camp. I'll give you a couple seconds to figure that out on your phones. Okay, you can put your phones down next to your dinner. A little breach of etiquette, but that'll be okay. And please put them on silent. Before we lift off tonight, I'd like to recognize some very distinguished guests who are in attendance tonight. Please hold your applause until the end. With us from the Alabama House of Representatives and representing the Alabama Space Science Exhibit Commission, we have State Representative Howard Sanderford and his wife Dot. We also have from the Alabama Space Science Exhibition Commission, the governing board of the U.S. Space and Rocket Center, Chairman Wayman Burke and his wife Jan. Also with us, Redstone Arsenal Garrison Commander Colonel Doc Holliday. And a big thank you tonight to Jill Eskew with Orbital ATK, the presenting sponsor for tonight's ceremony, for Orbital ATK's abiding support of this event, Space Camp, and the U.S. Space and Rocket Center. We'd also like to thank supporting sponsor Aerojet Rocketdyne for tomorrow morning's alumni breakfast. We're also very honored tonight to have several astronaut guests with us. Space Camp alumna and Hall of Famer, Dottie Metcalf Lindenberger. Clayton Anderson, Hall of Famer Captain Robert Hood Gibson, Frank Culberson, and one of tonight's inductees, Dr. Serena Auñón-Chancellor. Also tonight with us from the U.S. Space and Rocket Center Foundation Board, Jan Smith. And from Space Camp's sister location in Izmir, Turkey, we have International Marketing and PR Manager Beth Mitchell Ginsell. From across the nation, we have with us members of the Space Camp Alumni Advancement Board and members of the Space Camp Hall of Fame. As I call your name, please stand to be recognized. Major Phil Smith, Lieutenant Colonel Burke Hare, Dr. Liz Warren, Danny Hackis, Paycom Penny, Penny Pettigrew, Vincent Vazo, Dottie Metcalf Lindenberger, Robert Perlman, Marlene Mackey, Dan Oates, Josh Whitfield, Michelle Lucas, Dr. Andrea Hansen, and Dr. Jim Allen. And of course, tonight's inductees, Dr. Serena Auñón-Chancellor, Dr. Michelle Christensen, Major John Hecker, and Dr. Jennifer Heldmann. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me in welcoming and thanking these distinguished guests tonight. To kick off the 2017 Hall of Fame induction ceremony, we have a very special treat for you. Are you ready? This year, as I said, marks the 35th anniversary of Space Camp. And since opening the doors in the summer of 1982, nearly 800,000 young men and women, teachers, adults, have passed through that sign that says, "Through these doors walk the astronauts, the scientists, the engineers, the leaders of our future." Tonight, we are honored to have an alumni representing a class from each of these many, many years. When I call their name and year, I want everyone who attended camp that year to please stand and cheer. Do you remember what year you attended space camp? Okay, here we go. Class of 1984, Rod Milam, who is the producer of the Higher Education Channel in St. Louis, Missouri. Class of 1986, Dr. Deborah Barnhart, Executive Director of the U.S. Space and Rocket Center, Huntsville, Alabama. Class of 87, Robert Perlman, Space Historian, Houston, Texas. Class of 88, Troy Roberson, Software Engineer, Birmingham, Alabama. Class of 89, Penny Pettigrew, Paycom Penny, Huntsville, Alabama. Class of 1990, Tara Sweeney, Cochet Zero G in Fitchburg, Massachusetts. Class of 1991, Jeff Smith, Chief Projectionist, U.S. Space and Rocket Center, Bourbonnais, Illinois. Class of 92, Charles Lawson, Professional Photographer. Class of 93, John Retnotswani of Chicago, Illinois. Class of 94, Michelle Lucas, founder and president of Higher Orbits, Hobart, Indiana. Class of 95, Alicia Carroll. 96, Andrea Trebo, education crew trainer here at the Space and Rocket Center. Class of 97, Trevor Daniels, chief of staff of the U.S. Space and Rocket Center, ARAB, Alabama. 1998, Mike Brennison, aerospace engineer. 99, Sarah Hunting, crew trainer, U.S. Space and Rocket Center, Kirkland, Washington. Class of 2000, Diane O'Keefe, public librarian, Flint, Michigan. 2002, Ben Chandler, Space Camp Alumni Association chair, Cleveland, Tennessee. Class of 2002, Kelby Pearson. Class of 2004, Blake Parker, software engineer, Marshall Space Flight Center, Cullman, Alabama. Class of 2006, Karen Vincent, crew trainer, Space and Rocket Center. 2007, Amanda Doherty, crew trainer, U.S. Space and Rocket Center, New Mexico. 2008, Vincent Vazo, computer engineer, Huntsville, Alabama. 2009, William Hudson, crew trainer, U.S. Space and Rocket Center, Greensboro, North Carolina. 2010, Alyssa Carson, student and public speaker, Baton Rouge. Class of 2011, Rosemary Cortelli, student at UAH, from North Carolina. 2012, Renee Driver, also a student. 2013, J.C. Ezel, student and Mars Generation trainee, Olympia, Washington. Class of 2014, Nico Banks, student, Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University in my home state of Florida, Signal Mountain, Tennessee. And class of 2015, Autumn Rhodes, student and Civil Patrol Airman, Fort Myers, Florida. Class of 2016, Justice Hayde, student, along with his sister, Kaylee. All here tonight, all representing the 35 years of Space Camp. Very nice. You all haven't aged a bit. Our first speaker tonight came to work at the U.S. Space and Rocket Center when she was just 19 years old. And it was right here, inside one of those F1 engines of the Saturn V moon rocket, that she actually held a swearing-in ceremony that led to nearly three decades in the U.S. Navy. During her service, she was among the first 10 women assigned to active duty aboard ships. She retired at the rank of captain. She has served as vice president of three Dow 30 aerospace and defense companies. She holds degrees from the University of Alabama, Huntsville, the University of Maryland, the Massachusetts Institute for Technology, and Vanderbilt University. She holds the highest civilian honor from NASA, the Distinguished Public Service Medal, and she was recently inducted into the Alabama Academy of Honor, a group of just 100 living Alabamians whose actions have greatly benefited the people and the great state of Alabama. Please welcome to the stage, CEO and Executive Director of the U.S. Space and Rocket Center, Dr. Deborah Barnhart.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're really lucky tonight to have some stars of the Mars Generation film that you saw, the Netflix movie that has been turned into 40 languages, I think in about 150 countries. So we're delighted tonight to have several of the, I would say actors, but they were really young people who were just here going through Advanced Academy at the time. We have with us J.C. Zell, if you would stand, Jace, Alyssa Carson, Rachel Ward, and Nico Blanks. Yeah. The Mars Generation. You know, we've had this Space Camp alumni organization for a few years now, but we're really at a new era with the Space Camp alumni because they are now driving themselves. They're owning their own organization. We don't tell them what to do or what kind of activities to engage in. And they are the lasting element that will remain after administration leaves this place. They're the keepers of the flame, as I think you can see, and that flame seems to be very alive after our little parade. You're our insurance for the future, alumni, and you're the people that I'm counting on to make sure this place is here 100 years from now after we're all gone. We've had a record year. 2016 was a record-breaking year in Space Camp with over 35,000 trainees, and we are on track in 2017 to beat that. So Space Camp continues to grow over the past 7 years in double digits. We are also building our ranks. Yeah, thanks, I'm happy about that too. Yeah. We're also building the ranks of the Alumni Association. Ben Chandler, our president of the association, tells me that we have about 35,000 contacts with our alumni, and we just recently were able to find out about 66,000 more good email addresses or contact points for our alums. So I want to ask all of you alumni, as you move about your life throughout the world, please, when you come into contact with someone who's been to Space Camp, ask them to join the Alumni Association. You know it doesn't cost anything. We want to keep up with you. We want to know where you go in life and what happens to you and what you achieve after you come through Space Camp. Really, I think you can feel already, ladies and gentlemen, that Space Camp is not just a week-long program. Space Camp is a tribe. Space Camp is a family. Tonight, our family is grieving. We lost one of our dearest and sweetest crew trainers who'd been with us for several years, Ms. Heather Westfall. Heather was a crew trainer here and a great favorite. She became one of our managers. And her husband, Scott, and their family are here with us this evening. Scott asked Heather to marry him right after a parent-child graduation, I think he told me. So Space Camp is not just something that happened to them, not just a place they worked. It's part of their life, and they're part of our family. We wanted to show our love and expression to that family, and so we will be giving a scholarship in honor of Heather Westfall to Space Camp. And we also invite you to join us in honoring the family through our GoFundMe account. And the address for the GoFundMe account is Team Heather Angel. We love you, Scott, and your family. We're so glad you came tonight. Yet another very difficult but profound evidence of our Space Camp family tonight is witnessed by the fact that Major John Hecker is here with us. He's soon to be inducted into our Alumni Hall of Fame in just a few minutes. But John has come here tonight directly from Mississippi, where he had the difficult job of sending home to rest the 16 Marines, the one Navy sailor, in his unit, in his KC-130 unit. And he made sure that those shipmates and friends were sent home to their families, and then he and his family came to join us. Would you all stand to please honor those shipmates and service members of Major John Hecker? John, we love you and we thank you for your service. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. You may be seated. Alumni and friends, thank you for supporting our family. Thank you for supporting the Space and Rocket Center. Thank you for supporting the Alumni Association. Our future, it lies in your hands. You're the ones who are going to care the very most about Space Camp as we go into the future. We need you to help us. We are ready to grow. Space Camp is at capacity. We have 932 beds on this campus. This past week, we graduated over 1,000 people. Some of them were teachers who had to stay over at the UAH campus because we didn't have room for them. And this coming week, we'll have 926 trainees on board with us. So we are reaching our capacity. I want you to know there is a wonderful future in front of us. It's good to be busy, and it's good to have these kind of growing problems. We have already had a corporation from Huntsville come forward to be a donor for a new digital planetarium for the Space and Rocket Center. Intuitive Research Corporation has committed to a new planetarium. Next week, we will be piloting yet another camp, Space Camp, Aviation Challenge, Robotics, and next week we will pilot the U.S. Cyber Camp with the help of Cyber Huntsville and their initiative. And we are currently heavily engaged in master planning for the entire campus. As you know, the feng shui here is a little rough. We got a building over there and a building over here, and you can't get there without going out in the weather. So we've long wanted a connector building between the two of us. Well, we got a darn good reason for building one when the director of the Marshall Space Flight Center, Todd May, came to me and he said, "Deborah, I'm going to give you all the engineering development hardware for the space launch system." So ladies and gentlemen, you can look forward to the Space and Rocket Center having the only space launch system in the country and probably for decades to come, the only one anywhere in America. We will be putting that in a building that will house our cyber camp and will finally join the two buildings of the Space and Rocket Center. So we're looking forward to that. If you would like to hear more about some of our visions and plans that are in our path, you can come tomorrow morning. There's a breakfast at the Marriott at 10:30, and you're welcome to come and join us to hear more about the plans for the Space and Rocket Center. I just want to repeat to the Alumni Association that you are our future. You are the ones I'm hanging my hat on. No matter who's on our commission, no matter who has my job or the jobs of the other folks who work here with me, and by the way, thank you to every one of you who work here with me every day. I cannot say enough about the quality of the staff, the dedication, the love, the passion. I hope you can feel it the minute you walk in the door. We call it the thump, and we also call it the Hotel California, because once you check in, you cannot leave here. It's just part of it. Our foundation is getting stronger and stronger. The foundation is the arm of the Space and Rocket Center that ensures that we have a future and that we are funded to do the projects that we need to do. We have so much respect for the alumni that we created a seat on our foundation board for the president, and Mr. Ben Chandler currently holds that seat, and Andrea Hansen, the rising president, will take a seat on our board as well when she becomes the president of the Alumni Association. The foundation is welcoming to the alumni, and you're just one of the many bricks that are going to make sure we're here 100 years from now. You provide that linkage for us and that assurity that as we go into the future, this place will always be here. One other thing I want all of you to do to make sure that this place is always here as we go forward is to be sure that you are supporting the program both from our country and from the commercial space industry. It's not just us and them anymore, as General Bolden will tell you, I'm sure. You know, we've ridden NASA all the way to the moon, but today many commercial companies are also developing prodigious capabilities in commercial space, and tonight we will honor one of our Hall of Fame inductees. She is one of the leading engineers at one of those wonderful commercial companies, Blue Origin. So it's not us and them anymore, it's we. NASA is providing for you the historic benefits since the days of this beautiful vehicle above us. We're all seeing the benefits that come out of space travel, and it's only costing us less than half of 1% of our national budget. So I encourage you to continue to encourage your legislators and congressmen to support the NASA budget and to support commercial space, because I'm telling you, it's going to take all of us on our journey to Mars. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming this evening. Thank you for your support. Hey, Jill, I gotta get Jill Eskew up here. I knew there was one person I forgot to thank. And that's tonight's sponsor, Orbital ATK. Jill, thank you so much for sponsoring us. Jill Eskew is the Huntsville resident manager of Orbital ATK, and they're here supporting NASA's Space Launch System program. She's a heritage Morton Thiokol employee, so you've been around a while helping this program grow and continue to achieve. The one thing I love about Orbital ATK is they are a stellar company, they are a stellar community neighbor here in Huntsville, and they love this alumni event. Every year they come to the end and say, don't let anybody else sponsor the Hall of Fame, we want that. And I think it's highly intelligent, it's greatly appreciated, and I can assure you, Jill, that we are creating the workforce that's going to help Orbital ATK continue to excel in the future. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome Jill Askew from Orbital ATK.
Tonight, I'm proud to represent Orbital ATK. Our company works very closely with Marshall Space Flight Center on NASA's Space Launch System on boosters. And it's exciting to be part of NASA's Space Exploration Program. When I was first asked to make a few comments tonight on behalf of Orbital ATK, I tried to remember what my first space camp memories were. I'm nearly a Huntsville native, so some of my memories go back a long ways. I even remember when they moved the museum from Redstone Arsenal to the current location. I've attended Corporate Space Camp and Corporate Aviation Challenge, but those are not my first memories. My first memories of Space Camp are when my graduating classmates were applying to be the very first crew trainers, and they were housing the campers on the UAH campus. Space Camp's changed a lot. As corporate sponsors of Space Camp, we have the opportunity to interact with the Space Academy campers throughout the summer, and I can tell you it's a very dynamic program. When you talk to the campers and ask them, what's your favorite part? They almost always say, the missions. Dr. Barnhart and her staff have mastered the craft of writing STEM-based curricula and mission simulations that are not only educational, but they're engaging and fun. Fun enough that kids want to come back and do it again. Space Camp has over 750,000 graduates, so you know some pretty neat people have come through this program. Last Friday, I listened as astronaut Dr. Don Thomas spoke to each of the graduating classes, and he told all of them, don't listen to anyone who tells you you can't do something. Tonight, we're surrounded by Space Camp alumna who have heeded that advice and gone on to do great things. Tonight, Orbital ATK is proud to sponsor the Space Camp Hall of Fame dinner. Thank you.
Thank you, Jill. Thank you, Deborah. We want to also note that you are going to be receiving a very special gift from local artist Jill, from Julie Gill, who is at Big Glass Art. So be expecting that in just a few minutes. Major General Charlie Bolden's NASA career began when he joined the astronaut office back in 1980 in the middle of a 34-year career with the Marine Corps. General Bolden flew four missions aboard the space shuttle between 1986 and 1994, commanding two of the missions and piloting the two others. After his final shuttle flight, General Bolden left NASA and returned to active duty with the Marine Corps Operating Forces as the Deputy Commandant of Midshipmen at the U.S. Naval Academy in Annapolis. General Bolden was nominated by President Barack Obama and confirmed by the U.S. Senate as the 12th Administrator of NASA. He began his duties in July of 2009. As administrator, Charlie Bolden led a nationwide NASA team to advance the missions as well as the goals of the U.S. space program. During his tenure, he oversaw the same transition from 30 years of space shuttle missions to a new era of exploration focused on full utilization of the International Space Station. He has led the agency in developing a space launch system rocket design, as you know, in our own backyard right here in Huntsville, as well as the Orion crew capsule that will carry astronauts deep into space. Under Bolden's leadership, the agency's support of commercial space transportation systems for reaching low Earth orbit have enabled successful commercial cargo resupply missions for this space station. And in addition to all these accomplishments, General Bolden oversaw a dynamic portfolio of science activities, including the landing of the Mars rover Curiosity, the launch of the Juno spacecraft toward Jupiter, also toward the 2018 launch of the James Webb Telescope, the successor to Hubble. General Bolden has a passion for inspiring and truly educating the next generation. If you've ever had an opportunity to talk to him, he beams when you talk about children. Dr. Barnhart and many of the Space and Rocket Center staff will tell you that every time Charlie Bolden was at the Marshall Space Flight Center on work during an all hands or coming to check on equipment or the status of some program, he would always, always try to make sure, and I don't know a time when he didn't come over to the U.S. Space and Rocket Center and sit down with all of those individuals who were right here going through the training, experiencing space camp or aviation challenge. He really is a true friend of the U.S. Space and Rocket Center, and we are so proud to have him here tonight. And as a news anchor who has covered space since Charlie Bolden first started flying, and having 7 years of interviewing him as a NASA administrator, I have learned that he has an enormous heart and he's a softie from the get-go. And there's always one thing when you're interviewing Charlie Bolden that he never has. Well, tonight he's gonna have it. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the podium former NASA administrator, General Charlie Bolden. Open it up.
Uh-oh. Oh, get out of here. She's absolutely right, as a matter of fact. All right, I'll try not to use these tonight. Thank you very much, however. Liz, I really appreciate your very kind remarks and everything. Now, let me start by saying you all are much too quiet. Way too quiet. I listened and, you know, when the March of Years, is that what we called it? The Parade of Years was coming down. I think it was only the class of, was it 84 that got a halfway rowdy over there? All right. Every class should have been yelling and screaming. You know, I come from the United States Naval Academy. And one of the things that I learned there was, anytime anyone says anything about their class, then you outclass them. You know, like if somebody says class of 93, I'm a class of 68. So, oh, get out of here, Frank Culberson. One of my plebes. So, get lively here. This is a lively evening. I want to correct one thing that, I'm not correcting something that Dr. Barnard said, but I want to make sure that you don't misunderstand what she said. When she talked about all that NASA does with less than 0.5% of your taxpayer dollar, she was not saying that in meaning that's good. What she meant was NASA does what they do with only 0.5% of your taxpayer dollar, and she, because she's still working here, probably didn't want to say, and that's unsatisfactory. That is far too sufficient, far too insufficient. So I will add to what Deborah said by saying NASA needs more than 0.5% of the federal dollar. Liz, I want to thank you again for agreeing to come in and serve as the mistress of ceremonies for tonight. You are always, it's always great to be with you. And Liz is, let me tell you, if you've never been interviewed by a real news anchor, you're in for a treat. Liz and I have been going back and forth, as she said, since I can remember coming to Huntsville. I want to thank Dr. Deborah Barnard again for inviting me to come up here. But I also want to thank her for her tireless visionary leadership of this incredible team at the U.S. Space Camp. In addition to her, I also want to express my personal appreciation to the U.S. Space and Rocket Center Education Foundation's board for what you do to go out and do everything that you can to bring funds in that enable this great institution to continue to exist. And to Chair Jan Smith, I have not had a chance to say hello to you tonight, and I know you're out there somewhere, but I please accept my personal appreciation for all that you and the board of the foundation, the Education Foundation, do. In spite of all that we've said so far tonight, I don't want you to forget that we came here, we gathered here tonight to honor four superbly talented individuals who each have contributed in their own way to the goals, the aspirations, and the dreams of all of us in what I call the space community. Dr. Serena Auñón-Chancellor, NASA astronaut. Dr. Michelle Christensen, propulsion engineer from Blue Origin. Major John Hecker, U.S. Marine Corps retired Blue Angel pilot for Fat Albert and just plain old great Marine. Dr. Jennifer Hellman, NASA research scientist and program executive. And you'll hear more about each of them as soon as I get off the podium here. Congratulations also, however, to the, and I do want you all to give it up when I say this, but congratulations and a huge expression of appreciation to the families, the friends, and the co-workers of our honorees who have supported and encouraged them along the way. They would not be here tonight were it not for you. So please give yourselves a hand. Since the first Hall of Fame induction ceremony in 2007, the U.S. Space and Rocket Center Education Foundation has dedicated itself to providing the financial support to make it possible for children and adults from across the globe to make it possible for them to come here to Huntsville, Alabama, to get a firsthand experience that inspires them to dream big dreams and to believe in their ability to make a positive difference in our world. I think I mentioned to Deborah a little bit earlier, I know I did to several of you, you know, when I came in for the graduation this afternoon or this morning, when Serena and I were here and had the privilege of congratulating each of the 900 plus graduates, or how it seemed like forever. When you looked out there, I was surprised at how short it took to get them all handed their certificates. But as we went through, it was just unbelievably uplifting to say that is the future of our space program, of the world's space program. because what you saw were young boys and girls, men and women, from all around the world. And what impressed me probably more than anything, and I understand it's really due to the unbelievable efforts of Ed Buckby, who really has pushed to bring Chinese students here to space camp. And we had lots. And so as I go through the rest of my remarks, I hope you will keep in mind that for those of you who were here for the graduation, that's the face of the future of spaceflight. The blend of students from all over the world, all races, creeds, colors, nationalities, that's what's going to get us to Mars. Without that, we don't get there. I had a conversation with somebody a little bit earlier who was asking me, well, the Chinese, do you really feel good? Yes, I do. Because we are educating them, we are training them, and I really want to fly with them. So I think we'll get there. In 1977, a vision of Dr. Wernher von Braun brought to fruition the tireless efforts of Ed Buckby, who I mentioned earlier, and the U.S. Space Camp was born. It has now produced 3 flown astronauts and a soon-to-be flown astronaut in Dr. Auñón-Chancellor, and it has inspired thousands more to believe in our future in deep space. In an article in The Guardian on Saturday, July 25th, 2015, titled, Space Camp Has Kids Reaching for the Stars and Mars, Despite NASA Struggles. And I will take issue with the NASA struggles, but that's a topic for another day. But in the article, the author opined, and I quote, on the face of it, there doesn't seem to be much for the next wave of explorers and adventurers to get excited about. But he went on to talk about what he had experienced here at Huntsville, Alabama, at Space Camp. And I would add, if only he and others could feel the burning sense of optimism in the young people of today, those that we graduated this afternoon. My former boss, President Obama, referred to this group of people as the space generation, and we've used that term quite a bit tonight. He actually specified that they were the Mars generation. It is this optimism and hope that caused 18,300 people to apply for the 12 slots in the 2017 astronaut candidate class. It's the same optimism and vision that motivated Wernher von Braun to draft the first detailed technical study of a human mission to Mars in his 1952 work, Das Mars Project, and the 1956 updated plan with Willie Lee, the exploration of Mars. Why am I even more confident and optimistic than even von Braun may have been? Well, it's because of the explosion of commercial space in partnership with NASA in working to ensure a reliable, redundant, low Earth orbit infrastructure as a stepping stone or a stepping off point for human missions to the moon, to Mars, and other deep space destinations. I'm confident because of the strong international partnerships we have today. NASA has more than 800 active agreements with more than 120 countries in every area of work that NASA pursues. Not the NASA of the 20th century, by any stretch of the imagination, not the NASA of the Apollo era. It should not go without notice and amazement the almost 20-year partnership between the Russian space agency Roscosmos and the U.S. space agency NASA, in spite of the inability to strike a collegial, political, and diplomatic partnership between our two nations. I cannot help but believe that a 21st century Apollo-Soyuz type collaboration between the U.S. and China an ISS and Shenzhou mission is not too many years away. The world and our people are calling out for this, and it represents a potential infusion of renewed energy to our goal of humans on Mars, as well as human return to the moon. So my appeal to everyone here tonight is to dream big and to do what you can to guarantee the continuation and the expansion of the incredible work, the inspirational and motivational work of the U.S. Space and Rocket Center and its educational foundation. With your continued support, we can guarantee that the U.S. continues to lead and inspire the world in space exploration, and that our space agency, NASA, continues to turn science fiction into science fact and make the impossible possible. Congratulations again to the Space Camp Hall of Fame class of 2017. God bless all of you, and God bless our great United States of America.
Thank you, Charlie Bolden. The tissues were not because I made you cry. He's so passionate about the subject for which we are all here tonight. By the way, I guess I needed to show you this. You'll be receiving this in the mail. Stained glass, isn't that neat? Made right here in Huntsville. By Julie Gill at Big Glass Studios, so you'll always remember this night. Each year, the U.S. Space and Rocket Center opens nominations to the Space Camp Hall of Fame to the public under three categories: Space Camp alumni, former crew trainer or staff member, or friend of Space Camp. To be considered for any of these categories, one must have first demonstrated exceptional passion and dedication to furthering the mission and vision of Space Camp through one's own career and actions. Tonight's inductees will take their place among the very exclusive list of achievers, of pioneers, explorers, and of educators who currently make up the Space Camp Hall of Fame. Tonight's first inductee into the 2017 Hall of Fame is Serena Auñón-Chancellor.
Serena Auñón's 16th birthday present was a trip to Space Camp. She wanted to be an astronaut even then, but when she was assigned as her team's medical officer, she didn't know how prophetic it would be.
I remember it distinctly confirming for me, this is what I wanted to be. No question. This is what I wanted to be. Not any particular path, like, would I be an engineer? Would I be a physician? Would I be this? Would I be that? Just, this was my end goal. It reaffirmed, this is what I was supposed to do. Just a feeling. It was a feeling. It totally reaffirmed that.
25 years later, Dr. Serena Auñón-Chancellor is getting ready to launch to the International Space Station. Her assignment? Expedition 5859's medical officer. She's here tonight, flying from Star City, Russia, where she's training on the Russian Soyuz systems and the Russian segment of the ISS. She is scheduled for launch in November 2018. Serena first wanted to be an engineer like her father, but midway through undergrad at George Washington University, Serena took her friend's advice and added pre-med to her electrical engineering major. She was good with engineering, but she said something just clicked with medicine. But Serena never lost sight of space. She earned her MD in internal and aerospace medicine at the University of Texas Health Science Center at Houston, leading to an aerospace medicine clerkship at Johnson. After her residency at the University of Texas Medical Branch at Galveston, Serena became a flight surgeon for astronauts and cosmonauts in Houston and Star City. But working as a flight surgeon for spacefarers wasn't the end of the road. Serena wanted to be one herself.
And a lot of people say that the journey along the way is the best part in getting to your end destination. And it really has been, because I absolutely love being a doctor. But at the same time, since I was little, I've always wanted to be up there. I've always wanted to be in space.
In 2009, she was selected from more than 3,500 applicants as one of 14 astronaut candidates, along with fellow Space Camp alumna, Dr. Kate Rubens. Serena's NASA career has been varied. She searched for meteorites in Antarctica, living 200 nautical miles from the South Pole. In 2012, she operated the Deep Worker submersible for the Nemo 16 mission with fellow Space Camp alumna Dottie Metcalf-Lindenberger aboard. Then she served as an aquanaut aboard the Aquarius Underwater Laboratory for Nemo 20's undersea exploration mission. Now she's preparing for her own journey to space. She's looking forward to seeing how her own body reacts to microgravity, and she's excited about the science experiments she'll do in space. Another astronaut who is excited to see Serena reach space is Dottie Metcalf-Lindenberger, Serena's former teammate and fellow Space Camp Hall of Famer.
She's a super talented physician and doctor, but also she's able to talk to community members about the intricacies of space, and then she can turn around and have a lot of fun with kids. And I think that's really important as you're trying to share this piece of space with so many people. I'm so excited that Serena is getting this honor. It's very well deserved, and I'm more excited to see her fly in space. It's coming very soon, and all of us will share the enthusiasm while she's on the International Space Station.
Please welcome Space Camp Hall of Fame inductee, Dr. Serena Auñón-Chancellor. Inducting Serena are Hall of Fame members Dottie Metcalf-Lindenberger, Liz Warren, Andrea Hansen, and Michelle Lucas. Thank you so much. It's quite an honor to be here. I want to thank Dr. Barnhart, first of all, for having me, and U.S. Space and Rocket Center for inducting me. It is a huge honor. It's even better when your friends are there to do it for you. So Michelle, Liz, and Andrea, these are ladies I've been friends with for a long time. So that means a lot to me. Thank you so much. And to Dottie as well. I remember going to space camp vividly. And some folks say that some of your strongest emotions evoke the strongest memories. And the things that I remember from my space camp week, Space Academy really, I remember landing on the plane. I remember arriving at Huntsville Airport. I remember sitting at the medical officer position during our simulations. Now, I didn't realize that till years later when I looked back and thought, huh, that's ironic. I remember the friends that I met, and I remember flying home and having that feeling that I couldn't shake. And Dr. Barnhart called it the thump, and that's probably the best way to phrase it. There's something you feel inside. It's like a small flame has been lit, and it doesn't go out. So it was really an honor with General Bolden today to be able to have a little bit of time to speak with some of those Space Camp and Space Academy graduates, because you see that thump start to form in them, and you realize that a flame has been lit. And your hope is that they carry that flame with them as they continue their education, and they get bogged down again in the mundane schoolwork and everything else as they leave their time here. Because I know I carried that with me, and back then, when I applied for medical school and they said, what are your long-term plans? I said, I want to work for NASA. And they didn't know what to do with that. Because doctors working for NASA, there weren't very many of them, and they didn't know what to do with them, so they just kind of waved me off to the side and said, okay, whatever. But I held on to that dream, and that small flame was always there. It was always lit. It was always burning. And that propelled me to come to Johnson Space Center and do a clerkship. And the rest is history. So thank you again for letting me talk with those graduates, because when Charlie and I looked up into their eyes, and I know he'd tell you the same thing, you see it.
in their eyes. You see that passion, and you know our future's safe. So right now I'm training for my expedition scheduled for November of next year, and people say, what is your life like right now? And a lot of my life is spent away from the U.S., so I just spent 5 weeks out in Russia training on the Russian Soyuz and training on Russian systems. So that time is away from family, and it takes a lot of work, and any of you in the military know you're trying to prep your family before every trip and make sure the home front is stocked and ready to go. And I will have several more trips like that. The neat part about it is, and I was talking with several folks today, is that I hope that during my mission, we will see a test flight of a commercial vehicle. We will get folks on that vehicle, and they will dock to station successfully for the first time. Folks forget, I know not people in this room, but other people out there forget, we have been operating station, and it is a big international partnership for a very long time, and we've done very well with that. Station is like a busy parking lot. So one time I came in to do a Capcom shift, and anytime we have a commercial vehicle that is docked to station, we have a little stuffed animal that represents that commercial vehicle sitting on console. And I remember coming in, and there was a big stuffed dragon, and there was a stuffed swan, and I could barely see the console because of all the animals. And when I looked at station, we had Cygnus, we had Dragon, we had Progress, we had Soyuz, and we had HTV. So that should make people hopeful. Look at the international partnership and collaboration. Just a week ago, I taught a European astronaut how to make a s'more. Because we were standing there having a good old-fashioned weenie roast over a fire, and someone pulled out marshmallows, chocolate, and graham crackers, and Alex Gerst, he won't mind, he's gonna be commanding station this next year. And he said, what are you doing? And I said, Alex, I'm making a s'more. And he said, I don't know what that is. And so we taught him how, and he thought it was the best thing ever. But we have strong partnerships with all of our international partners. And what General Bolden said earlier was true. We need to maintain those strong partnerships because that is the only way we will press ahead and get our boots on Mars. So I am very hopeful, only because I think in the next 3 to 4 years, things are going to ramp up so dramatically that it's going to be tremendously exciting. What really gets me excited, though, is thinking about when we launch from American soil again. The best part about that is we still had 18,000 people apply for the Astronaut Corps. And you have over 900 kids coming next week to light that flame at Space Camp. So they are ready for the future. They are ready. They know what's coming and what's out there, and they are probably chomping at the bit to be a part of that. And that gives me hope. I know it gives you hope out there, because I can't wait to see what the future brings. But thank you so much. It is quite an honor to be inducted in. It's an honor to be with my fellow inductees tonight, and I hope you honor them as much as well. So thank you very much for having me here.
Our next inductee into the 2017 Space Camp Hall of Fame is Dr. Michelle Christensen.
Michelle Christensen began dreaming of space at 5 years old when her dad took her to the Kennedy Space Center during a family trip to Walt Disney World. Michelle said she was fascinated when her dad explained people went to the moon. She remembers looking up at a Redstone rocket and marveling at the engine. Michelle followed her passion for figuring out how things worked through science camps, fairs, and academic contests. She first discovered Space Camp watching the show Double Dare, where the grand prize was a trip to Space Camp. She started saving money to pay her share of the trip across the country. Then finally, at 14, she boarded a plane full of excitement and anticipation. Michelle remembers getting to camp and meeting students from all over the world. She found people just like her at space camp, people who also marveled at rocket engines and dreamed of going to space. Michelle said, "I always felt a little weird growing up. Meeting other people who had the same enthusiasm really helped push me forward." She returned to space camp in 11th grade and then joined the crew trainer team during a summer away from the University of Washington.
A day here at space camp is a very long and packed day, especially once they get to Advanced Space Academy. We wake them up somewhere around 7 o'clock in the morning and they will be continuously doing activities.
She met fellow crew trainers who were students at the University of Alabama in Huntsville, and she saw the great internships they had at the Marshall Space Flight Center. She stayed in Alabama taking space camp on the road in the Mission to Mars project until she qualified for in-state tuition. She often wonders what would have happened if she hadn't made that choice. After she earned her doctorate in mechanical engineering at Penn State, she landed a job at Blue Origin as one of only 160 employees. Today, Blue Origin has more than 1,000 people building Amazon founder Jeff Bezos' dream of rockets that launch into space and return safely to Earth, lowering the cost of spaceflight and opening the solar system to everyone. Michelle isn't looking up at rocket engines anymore. She's building them, leading a team of engineers working on the pre-burner phase of the BE-4 engine. At Blue, Michelle found the same kind of team she found at space camp, people like her working toward a common goal. When she's not at work, Michelle explores her creative side. "I started making jewelry because I enjoyed how you could manipulate metals," she said. It's no surprise many of her pieces are inspired by space and the vehicles that send us there. With each jewelry sale, Michelle makes a donation to the Alumni Association's Drive to 35 scholarship effort. Her goal is to inspire the next generation of engineers and explorers.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our next Space Camp Hall of Fame inductee, Dr. Michelle Christensen, inducted into this astute category tonight by Hall of Fame members Vincent Vazo, Marlene Mackey, and Jim Allen.
It's so exciting to be back here. This place has played such a huge role in my life. As you saw, since I was 5 years old, I've been totally excited about space. And that's kind of an interesting thing because I grew up in a very small town, and I was really the only kid I knew that was super into space. In fact, most kids had no interest at all. At school, other students would see me reading the Space Shuttle Operator's Manual and ask if I was studying to be an astronaut. I replied yes, and then became very embarrassed because no other kids I knew were studying to be astronauts. I came to Space Academy when I was 14, and for the first time in my life, I wasn't the nerdy, weird kid. I was just like everyone else. Kids from all over the world came together to accomplish the greatest mission of our lives. We flew to space, built a new space station, and conducted on-orbit experiments. We had to work hard, communicate well, and solve problems to have a successful mission. When I came back for Advanced Space Academy, where the missions are more complicated, this was even more apparent. Back home, I miss the camaraderie of a team of highly motivated people working toward a common goal. I kept in touch with many of the friends I made, and when I returned as a counselor, I continued to build my team. That team has now turned into a network of lifelong friends. Many of them are here today. I wouldn't be here without you all. I started thinking about what space camp really meant to me, and I realized that in every major accomplishment, I was a part of a team of highly exceptional people. And reflecting back on my time at space camp, I realized that that's the biggest lesson I learned, was how much you can accomplish working with a team of highly motivated individuals. I've carried this lesson with me, and I found it especially useful throughout my career. The most exciting moment of my life was the first successful landing of Blue Origin's New Shepard rocket. If you haven't seen the 400 Happy Rocket Scientists video on YouTube, you need to Google it. It's a video of the Blue Origin team watching that first landing, and it captures the true joy and emotion of a successful team that had worked for a very long time to accomplish a mission. I spent part of my first year at Blue designing the reaction control system and was super excited to see it fly. When the rocket landed, my first thought was, thank goodness my parts worked. You never want to be the reason that a mission fails. And then I started thinking, holy cow, the engine restarted and throttled down and shut down all at the right time. And then the aerodynamics, the control surfaces, the avionics, all the electronics, everything, every part on that rocket had to function as it was intended in order for the mission to succeed. Which meant every person on that team had to be successful at their task for us to accomplish the mission. That type of success is only achieved when people work together and communicate effectively. I knew what that looked like because those are skills that I learned here at Space Camp. Now I work on the BE-4 engine that will someday be used to fly people and satellites to orbit. Engine development is pretty challenging. We work really long days in a fast-paced environment. We deal with a lot of extremes that come along with a high-thrust rocket engine. And we test in a remote test site, which adds a lot of communication complications. But we work very hard, and every day I'm amazed at how intelligent all of my coworkers are and how hard we're willing to work together to see this engine fly. That's how I know that we will succeed again as a team. I recently found my Space Academy logbook, and there was a journal in it filled with stories that I wrote all about the friends that I made here, the missions that we did, and all the fun that we had together. It ended with, I now end the most fun, exciting, and altogether best 6 days of my whole life. So my time here set me up for success in a challenging field, showing me that what you can accomplish as part of a great team. So thank you to all of my teams, my new Space Camp Hall of Fame team, which have welcomed me so kindly, my family, who is my first original team, my friends, colleagues, and of course Space Camp. We've accomplished some really cool things together, and I can't wait to see what's next.
Our third inductee into the Space Camp Hall of Fame, Major John Hecker.
As his father's Army career took the family in and out of Huntsville, the U.S. Space and Rocket Center remained a constant in young John Hecker's life. In elementary school, he and his buddies would walk through the woods on Redstone Arsenal almost daily to visit Miss Baker and ride G-Force. John has not gotten to the stars, but he has soared high as a member of the U.S. Navy's fabled Blue Angels. John was part of the team for 3 years, piloting that big C-130, Fat Albert, and hundreds of air shows and demonstrations. I got to be part of one of the most inspirational units in history, John said. What's amazing is John didn't think about flying until he was 29. After Auburn University, he worked in television news as a producer. He decided only later to follow his father and brother into the military. He applied for the Marine Corps, but was told he was too old. On September 11, 2001, his recruiter called. Report to Quantico for Officers Candidate School in January. He became an aircraft commander and then a T-34 flight instructor. At the encouragement of friends, he tried out for the Blues, but he didn't make it the first time. He went for further training as a Naval Aviation Safety Officer, and with that on his resume, he made it. The Blues brought John more than a rewarding highlight in his career. When he was in Fort Worth, Texas, training on the C-140, he saw his future wife, Melody, on the soccer field. John recently left full-time service after more than 15 years and is preparing for a career in commercial aviation. He joined the Marine Reserves and will continue to fly his beloved C-130s. But he's not leaving the Blues or his time at space camp behind. Almost 30 years later, he still remembers the Flying Orbital Center, his team designed, and the presentation he made about it in Discovery Theater. He's a true professional Marine and a professional aviator, said his commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel Ike Eisenhower. As for John's induction into the Space Camp Hall of Fame, knowing John's work ethic and integrity, I'm not surprised, he said. His good buddy, Chad Driver, is also proud of his old friend, and maybe even a little jealous.
John, it's hard to believe that 28 years ago this summer at Space Camp, you and I developed the plans for the Flying Orbital Center, obviously the precursor to today's International Space Station. That's why it's such an honor to be jointly inducted here alongside you tonight into the Space Camp Hall. I'm not going in. John, if my math is correct, 28 years ago, this summer, you and I went to Space Camp. That's why it's so cool to be here with you tonight, to honor you, to say congratulations, and to tell you that my whole family's proud of you.
Please welcome Space Camp Hall of Fame inductee, Major John Hecker. Inducting John, our Hall of Fame members, Phil Smith, Hoot Gibson, Josh Whitfield, and Burke Hare.
Well, forgive me if I ramble a little bit. My time for writing down my speech kind of got taken away from me last week, and I wasn't expecting it, but I'll do my best to try and reach 15 minutes. When I first heard about this, the only thing I could think of was the TV show back in the 80s called The Greatest American Hero, and the theme song fit in so well. When I looked at the three beautifully intelligent women that are being inducted with me. And I read the lyrics from the first verse, and it makes me laugh. Look at what's happened to me. I can't believe it myself. Suddenly, I'm on top of the world. It should have been somebody else. I joke and I kid, but my fellow inductees are absolutely brilliant. And although I've done a few things, they almost feel like I pale in comparison. With that, I've heard a couple of things tonight that I want to hit on. One is family and one is inspiration. Space Camp is a family. Space Camp Hall of Fame is a family. And I've been inspired by family. I've been inspired by my family, by my mom and dad, by my brother, by my wife, and my beautiful daughter. I've been inspired by my Huntsville family, and I know there's a ton of them out here. By my Space Camp family in 1988, thanks Chad for being here to represent. By my Auburn University family, War Eagle. My Birmingham family, I've been inspired by them. My Marine Corps family, I've been more than inspired by them. My fellow aviators, the sumos, the shooters, the Blues, and now the Yankees, all a part of my family, a part of our family. And everybody has given me inspiration. My goal from here forward is to inspire you guys back. I hope I've done a little bit of it, but I still want to go up into space to tell you the truth. So I'm still hoping that I can inspire you all to do great things as well. But 28 years ago, just over in that hallway there, Chad and I stole a microphone, and I sang "You Light Up My Life" in front of everybody. And tonight I'm going to end my little speech with a song, because nobody sings during a speech except for me. But I'm just going to do the last verse. Believe it or not, I'm walking on air. I never thought I could feel so free. Flying away on a wing and a prayer. Who could it be? Believe it or not, it's just me.
Life is about moments and about making memories just like that. Tonight's final inductee into the 2017 Space Camp Hall of Fame, Dr. Jennifer Heldmann.
Space became real to Dr. Jennifer Heldmann when she was in the third grade.
So one night, my mom brought the telescope out onto the deck in the backyard, and we pointed it at the moon. And so I looked through the telescope, and I looked at the moon, and I was blown away, because when you look through this little telescope, you could see there were mountains and there were craters.
That vivid moment and Space Camp the movie set young Jennifer on her path. She and her friend Tara watched Space Camp so many times, they memorized it. She likes to remind me I would get mad if she messed up the lines, Jen said. Jen's mom sent her space-focused daughter to the real space camp. It was the very first time I was surrounded by people like me in this place dedicated to space, Jen said. The possibilities began to seem real. I still thank my mom for that. When she got to Colgate University, she majored in astrogeophysics, a degree that is equal parts astronomy, physics, mathematics, and geology. We may have one astrogeophysics major per year, her professor, Dr. Thomas Balanek, says. From Colgate, Jen went to the University of North Dakota, where she got a master's degree in space studies, and then to the University of Colorado for her doctorate in planetary studies. Today, she works for NASA, researching her old friend, the moon, as well as Mars. For her work, she travels to Mars analog environments, from the Australian outback to the Antarctic. Her work focuses on water and will help prepare for the human exploration of Mars. It's test before you fly, the space camp way, Jen said. If we figure it out on Earth, we're better prepared for the moon and Mars. While she has dozens of peer-reviewed publications and conferences, Jen really enjoys speaking to young people, just like she did when she worked at space camp while in college. The best job ever, she said. When she speaks to young people now, she encourages them to find something they love and to do something bigger than themselves. In addition to her demanding career, Jen and her husband, Dr. Adrian Brown, have 3 children, ages 6 to 8 months. And somehow, she manages to balance it all, just as she did at West Hill High School in Syracuse, New York.
Jen was probably the best student I ever had in my 30 years of teaching here at West Hill. She was an all-around good kid. She was in band. She played varsity soccer. She was editor of the yearbook. And she was very well-rounded.
She's much better at what she does than I am, her professor Balanik said. Of the over 100 students I have been very close to, she's easily one of the more successful and one of the students I am most proud of.
Please welcome Hall of Fame member Dr. Jennifer Heldmann. Inducting Jennifer tonight are Hall of Famers Dan Oates, Penny Pettigrew, Danny Hackis, and Robert Perlman.
Well, thank you very much, and I'm so honored to be here because it's Space Camp. There's nothing like Space Camp anywhere. So thank you for staying till the end of this, and I just really, really want to thank everyone that's here at the U.S. Space and Rocket Center and Space Camp itself. It has been so amazing to reconnect with Space Camp, and I can't wait to keep coming back because I hear the alumni are invited back all the time. So I will be returning. And I'm also super happy and excited that we actually live in a time where science and technology and space exploration are valued in our society. And it's a time when I'm so privileged to work at NASA. And I'm so encouraged because I feel like I've taken the Space Camp methodology and applied that to my career. Because that's what I do now. I lead teams and we run simulated missions. Like we go out to all these places around the Earth and we figure out, okay, what's the best way to send robots to other planets? When we send these amazing astronauts, how are they going to do the science and how are they going to do the field work and what kind of equipment do they need and which gloves work best and how do you teach someone to pick out the best rock on the moon and what science instruments do they need? And so we test that on Earth. And so it's exactly what we learned at Space Camp. And all of those driving, the background, teamwork, collaboration, working together, so incredibly important. And that's the only way that the teams work, and that's the foundation of Space Camp, in addition to the science and the technical side. So I'm really, really honored and privileged to be able to do that. And another thing that I'm really happy that I'm glad I can hopefully bring this out to the world some more now through Space Camp is there's a lot of educators that are here tonight. And so I just wanted to take a moment to emphasize the importance of the education and the inspiration, because that has been something that's been a common theme throughout this entire evening. And when I came to Space Camp, and another common theme, it was the first time where I was surrounded by people just like me. I couldn't believe it. There were people here that liked space and loved space as much as I could, or as much as I did. And I thank my mom, who's here tonight. We still don't actually know how we managed to get me to Space Camp from New York, because the furthest I'd ever traveled was Jersey, and I thought that was far. So I may still have a tuition bill. I'm not really sure. So if I do, somebody can come find me later. From all those years ago. And also another person that's here is Mrs. Ferguson, who is my high school earth science teacher, who you saw in the video. And she is the first person who taught me how planets work. I was like, oh, there's a method here. There's some science behind this. And it was really interesting. And then that's been my career path ever since, is studying planetary science. And so, and of course, as you saw in the video, Space Camp, the movie, played a huge part in my love of Space Camp, and I can still recite it, as I'm sure most people in this room can. And we used to get up late at night. You know, this is that spark and that passion where it's just something that was always in you. We used to get up, and my friend Tara, who introduced me to the movie, would play Space Camp at night. I apologize to my mom, because we would get up in the middle of the night and, like, go lay in front of the picture window, because you got to have stars in front of your cockpit and that sort of thing. And so it's just these small little things that just keep building and building. And it's like we heard earlier, it's that fire inside of you that just doesn't go away. So I'm really, really excited to be in the Hall of Fame. I can't believe that I'm up here. And as we heard, it's not just me, but it's everyone. It's all the support. It's all the community. It's NASA. It's the science side. It's the exploration side. And I'm just glad that we live in a time where we can do this exciting work. And hopefully we can inspire these campers that are coming through and the next generation. And I have my three children here now. And so I hope that I can do it well by them as my mom did by me. And whatever their passions may be, I hope that I can go the extra mile to help them find that. And we can hopefully instill that in all of the students that we have coming across our paths. So with that, I think I should probably wrap it up and say thank you very much. And I look forward to being part of the Space Camp family for many years to come.
What an inspirational evening. Do you all agree? It was terrific. And on that note, this does conclude the 2017 Space Camp Hall of Fame induction ceremony. Thanks again to our presenting sponsor, Orbital ATK, our keynote speaker, Major General Charlie Bolden, who's soon to be a children's book author, Rocket Center CEO Deborah Barnhart, the Dumadi women who have made your gorgeous centerpieces tonight, our Space Camp Hall of Fame inductees who have returned home to celebrate this amazing program. Take note, nominations are open now for the class of 2018. Those individuals will be inducted in the 2018 Space Camp Summer Fest that begins next year, July 12th through the 15th. And while you have your iPhones out marking your calendars, go ahead and mark for the ultimate Space Camp alumni experience as we celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Apollo 11 moon landing, July 18th through the 24th, 2019, 2 years from now, right here at the U.S. Space and Rocket Center. We will also be celebrating Alabama's 200th anniversary. Pretty neat. Also, remember you have about 15 more minutes to bid on your favorite item for the Space Camp Silent Auction. Remember, all the proceeds will help put someone through Space Camp who needs it. It is a scholarship fund. That's why we're here tonight. Also, please consider the donation. That easy way I mentioned a little while ago, 41444. Go ahead, when you dial that, you write in Camp 35. Support, train, inspire the next generation of explorers. And if you haven't already, think about purchasing your ticket for tomorrow night's really neat rock concert. It'll be out in Shuttle Park underneath the shuttle. It'll feature Party of the Year, the band that was actually put together by the producers of Black Jacket Symphony. They're going to rock out the hits of the 60s through today. So if you don't know the 60s, if you didn't sit in the car with your mom and dad to remember those or remember them first person, you'll enjoy tomorrow night anyway. The gates open at 6, concert begins at 7. Be sure also, do not miss the Science of Rock and Roll, Space Center's newest traveling exhibition. It opens this coming week on a limited engagement right here in Huntsville. Now, would all the Hall of Fame inductees, as well as General Bolden and tonight's sponsor, Orbital ATK, please come to the stage for some pictures. For the rest of you, thank you so much for being with us tonight. We will see you next year.